So when this program first started up, there were both undergraduate and pre-graduate student pathways. The program for students who already had bachelor's degrees, those who wanted to get into master's degree programs, the pre-graduate student pathway courses, they didn't have college credits attached to anything at all. It was really just a preparation program. Let's talk about that program first, since there's probably a little less controversy about it. Now, depending on how the student tested in with the TOEFL, they'd take one or two semesters of EAP coursework, some of which were based on regular content courses. The courses were written for these pre-graduate student pathways, but they were based primarily on undergraduate content syllabi. But the students in that pathway were not earning college credit for those classes. They were just enrichment-style courses to give them a chance to learn how to deal with their content, with the reading, writing papers, not plagiarize, that kind of thing. Now, if they met the exit test requirements, you know, the minimums for the GPA, then they could matriculate into graduate programs at Bay City with mainstream students. Now, originally, the undergraduate pathway was only for students who had already completed a year of undergraduate credits in their home country. You know, this so that they could be considered transfer students when they came to Bay City University. Well, that's changed. They no longer have to have earned credits prior to being admitted. I'm not sure how they managed to work that out. I think they're non-degree seeking students that first year. So in the undergraduate pathway, there are credits attached to some of their courses, the content courses, but none of the ESL courses are for credit. The curriculum for the pathway students' content courses isn't the same as it is for domestic students. And there was a real problem with that because we wanted it to be, well, people wanted it. I didn't personally have a strong opinion about all this stuff, but the idea was that if students were going to be earning college credit for a history course, for example, right? So if there was going to be that first year history elective or whatever, then that course should follow the same curriculum. But the College of Arts and Sciences didn't want us to duplicate that curriculum. They said they owned that curriculum. Why should we, you know, why should we have it in the College of Adult Education? So we had to write our own curriculum, you know, which actually wasn't such a bad idea anyway, because most of the students couldn't possibly have gotten through that mainstream freshman curriculum anyway. But here's the thing. On the university transcripts that pathway students get, it doesn't identify their content course as being from the pathway program. It would just be coded as freshman history. So for someone looking at this from the outside, it's just Bay City University transcript showing credits in freshman history. And we had a lot of discussions about that. And you know, you might say we actually, well, dumbed it down for the pathway students. And I know that some people actually did. But I'd like to think that if we had a particular group of students from a different culture, and if they had to learn about U.S. history, well, that there should be a different way of approaching U.S. history with this group. And that it didn't have, you know, they don't have the same background as people who grew up in the United States and are more familiar with the traditions and somewhat of its history that they learned in high school. You can't teach them exactly the same thing as you would an American student. Teachers need to respond to the people that are in front of them. So you need to be able to approach history in a different way. But the problem with that is, of course, you just don't get through all that much material. You can't possibly meet all the objectives from the mainstream curriculum. You're always teaching new vocabulary. You're dealing with just the most basic. Suddenly you have to explain all that stuff. And then, of course, yes, you're not delivering the same history course, not by any means. But it does appear on the transcripts as Bay City University undergraduate history. And now there is a disparity in that non-pathway international students who matriculated on their own, they actually do have to take mainstream U.S. history course, you know, without the prior knowledge, and maybe they'll end up getting a lower grade than the pathway student who got, let's say, the easier pathway history curriculum. So there's a bit of a disparity there. Yeah, just a bit. And actually, you know, we didn't have consistency of content syllabi across sections in the pathway. Each content instructor would design their own. They basically designed their own course, and they'd use whatever textbook that they wanted to use. Now, I have to say that, you know, the content faculty weren't really overseen. And I think there was some sense that they should have been, you know, and that they needed to get done, but, you know, it wasn't getting done. I had a lot to do, and honestly, I wasn't necessarily qualified to do that myself. I think now that more full-time faculty have been taking on, from what I've heard, and quite a few of them are in the content areas, I'm sure that there's more oversight now. But even when I was still there, at some of the faculty meetings that we would have, you know, there'd be ESL and content faculty in the same room, and there would be disputes about standardized curriculum, whether all sections for a particular course should be following the same syllabi, curriculum, whatever, or should everybody be doing their own thing. And that is much more of an issue with content area people, you know? They have ideas about faculty autonomy, and that's not such a strong idea in ESL. ESL teachers will generally, I don't know, if you tell them that this is the deal, we use this textbook, and here's what you have to do, they'll generally go along with that. For an IEP, it's kind of important that all sections of a level 4 writing course prepare students for level 5, you know? I think ESL teachers are more at peace with standardization. But I think that a lot of the content faculty will rebel against, you know, that kind of an idea and say, I'm faculty, I know what to do, I should be able to choose my own book. But now, I'm sure that over there now, there is more of a sense that there needs to be more unity brought to the program. And I think there's a sense that it is a program, so students are supposed to be at a certain point by the end of it. It's just really been hard. There hasn't been enough oversight. There really just wasn't anything.